It's a great honor for me to introduce Audrey Zibelman, the chair of the New York State Public Service Commission. We're very gratified at the law school to have such a great leader in energy policy with us here today. Chair Zibelman is a lawyer by training, and she has extensive experience in the energy industry in many different capacities in the public and the private sectors. For example, she was the founder and past president of Viridity Energy. She was executive vice president and chief operating officer of PJM. And in light of her wealth of experience in the industry, I think you'll agree with me that New York State's extremely fortunate to have her as the chair of the PSC, a position that she's held since September 2013. So we're very pleased to have Chair Zibelman here today to speak with us, and very much look forward to her insights this afternoon. Great. Thank you very much.
Thank you. I put this down. One of the great problems of being short. I hope you see more than my head. Is that okay? Can you hear me all right? So first of all, I want to express my appreciation for the law school for hosting this conference. I, as someone who's been around the energy industry a long time, I think that we are now at, I think since I've been in it in 1988, really at a time of great excitement. We've been in it for a few years, but I think most of us would say we are on the cusp of being able to see a fundamental and transformative change in the industry that will be to the benefit, certainly, of customers. But I think in particular in New York, we have a tremendous opportunity in front of us to demonstrate leadership that could be used across both the country and actually worldwide on how you can change this industry to provide benefit from an economic, from a environmental, and certainly from a security basis of making sure that we have a power grid that actually grows and supports the economy in the best way possible. So thank you. I think this is probably the most important topic that we have to talk about when we talk about energy, is how did this work, and I appreciate the opportunity to be here. With that, let me just start. Does anyone in the room remember Ken Olson from DEC? Well, one of his famous quotes, that shows you how old you are, by the way, is in 1977. He said that no one ever is going to want a personal computer in their home. DEC no longer exists, and I don't know where Ken Olson is. Bill Gates also has a quote in 1981. He said that we're never going to need any more than 641 kilobytes of energy. Unfortunately, Bill did not listen to himself, but Ken might have. Point of my, what I'm bringing up here is, I think a couple things. Is we really are sitting here with a vision of where we want to drive the industry. And one of the things that we know is when we forecast and try to predict the future, in all likelihood, we're going to guess wrong. And that particularly when it comes to technology, it's probably going to exceed our expectations and we can't even imagine it. Closer to home, you know, we talked a little bit about telecom today. When Judge Green issued his famous order about unbundling the telephone industry, I'm sure he had a vision in mind. I'm also sure it wasn't the smartphone. But the issue really is not that we have a vision and we know with certainty that that vision is going to be a reality. The fact is that we have a vision and we put ourselves on the right path to achieve that vision and remove the impediments that might exist that are preventing us from that today. And a lot of what I'm going to be talking about is really what I see as the role of regulators and the role of government. Is one is certainly you have to start with a vision. But the second is really thinking about what's the path we need to get on, what are the impediments we need to remove, and how do we make sure that we can continue to evolve and learn as we learn, as we think about these transitions. So with that, I have really three things that I want to cover. One is to identify what our take on is on the factors that are really driving this change. Second is talk a little bit about the policy vision we have for the industry in New York. And that's been expressed both in our state energy plan and the commission's order at the end of the year, talking about the proceeding we were opening up to develop the utility of the future. And the third is to talk about what I see as some of the key elements that the commission is going to need to address and think about, and really the changes that we're going to have to make in order to get us on this right path. So beginning first with what the key factors, and a lot of these people have talked about, but I'm going to continue to take these on and off because I can't see you when they're on and I can't see the words when they're off. But one is certainly aging infrastructure. So regardless of anything else that happened, most of the electric grid that was built that serves a lot of these regions is older than 30, 40, 50 years. And it's infrastructure and technology that was really developed in the last century. So what we need to think about, and this is not a New York issue, this is a countrywide issue, is the fact that this infrastructure needs to be replaced. In our state energy plan, we talked about the fact if we look at New York alone, and this would be everything, transmission, distribution, generation, we're looking maybe at $60 billion of investment that we're going to have to make to replace this infrastructure. The second is the needs around resiliency, climate change. We just completed our Con Ed rate case. Part of that rate case was a collaborative among the utility, the city, a number of NGOs, and as well as consumers, to really start thinking about the hard issue of we can't build as we build in the last century. We have issues in terms of addressing climate. And we need to think about levels of resiliency and what do we build to. And I think that's one of the things that came out of that collaborative was, a couple of things. One is a great understanding. You had a lot of different viewpoints coming together. The other is a sort of recognition of what's that standard that we're going to need to build to in the future. So it's not just replacing, but it's really future-proofing. And what does that really mean? The third is the issue in terms of security, both cyber and physical. It's a reality. We need to think about it on the cyber side. How do we get information? And in the transmission side, we talk about it as sort of a visibility, situational awareness. It's a real-time system. And so what does that mean in terms of control and data? And it's true on the distribution grid as it is on the wholesale grid. The other piece is customer demands. I mean, one of the things that we have is that we move towards a digital economy. Customers' requirements on reliability and service quality continue to increase. I mean, it's not just in terms of demand of energy, but what they want. Plus, we have a different complement of customers. So if we talk about commercial and industrial customers who want 100% uptime, they need it. We had a number of industrials from New York into our offices a few months ago talking about how with power quality, a small perturbance on the grid that nobody would see in New York City can cause them to lose an entire inventory in upstate because everything is so sensitive. So what do we need? So those types of things. Plus recognition around the availability of renewable resources, solar, distributed energy, all those types of things that customers are really moving way further from, well, I just want to be able to pick my commodity supplier, to actually giving them real choice about how much they want to buy, what they want to buy, do they want to own it, and more importantly, what information do they want? The other thing that I realize is that as we move forward and the demographics of customers change, and they become people who have been used to technology their whole lives and having information their whole lives, their desire to have information is going to, and control what they do is going to continue to increase. So we need to think about that and think about how do we give customers that real choice. The other piece is technology. You know, there's a lot of studies of going on. Certainly the cost of solar, the cost of wind, the cost of renewable resources continues to decrease. So we are starting to talk about grid parity. We're also talking about control technologies, information technologies. There's actually technologies on the distribution and transmission grid where before that you had latency issues and things would have to were looked at in 15-minute cycles can actually be dealt with in 4-second cycles. What does that really mean? It means you can operate the system that much more efficiently because you can't get away from the basics. Electricity is a real-time product. utilities have to worry about, well, if something goes down, I have to be able to replace, I have to create redundancy. But as the system becomes smarter and more efficient and more nimble, what that does is that the utilities can have much more situational awareness, both transmission and distribution operators, and now we can operate in a much more efficient way because they're going to be able to respond much, much more quickly. What I talk about is like driving through a dark highway with your lights on versus your lights off. The more we can put the lights on, the better we can drive and the better the utility can operate. So it's giving them that information. So all of that is causing some changes, and one of the major changes is really thinking about it in terms of what the utility, the grid of the future looks like. When I say grid, I'm not talking about just the distribution utilities. The distribution utility, it's the resources that sit behind the meter that consume energy. It's the resources that sit behind the meter that produce energy. It's the transmission grid. It's the generators. It's really how it all works together. And when you think about it, we built the grid in the last century because technology really limited us to that, is where we built central station generation, transmission, distribution, with the expectation that we really couldn't control demand on the system, and we had to meet that instantaneous demand. And that secondly, as someone mentioned in the last panel, it was a great way to talk about it, that this was a good that was basically infinite. So people can consume as much as they wanted, and the utilities had an obligation to meet it. Now we're moving to it really another reality where we can start controlling demand on this, at the edge of the system. And so now we can really talk about the grid as it is, which is a single machine, and really thinking about creating it as a series of distributed networks that operate really collectively to drive much more efficiently. And the goal for that, and the reason why that's important, is you go back to these factors. We can't, as people keep talking, as load keeps going down, we can't replace the existing system on a business as usual basis. We can't afford it. Electricity is so expensive. You look at the New York economy, the one thing that we can do is make sure it remains affordable. So we can't afford to take any investment and not think about it holistically as how does it drive a more efficient system, whether it's a DG that sits behind someone's meter, whether it's an investment a utility can make on the system to run the system more efficiently, and therefore take all of these public goods that we have to achieve and do it in the most efficient way possible. So that's why you're hearing why we have to rethink it. And one of the things, and because this is a CLE, I do want to quote a statute so that way you can all say you did study some law here, is really why would the public utility, someone asked the question, is this a regulatory issue? The one thing I think is important to note is that clearly under the public service law, 65.1, I even looked it up, the utility has the obligation to provide safe and adequate service that in all respects is just and reasonable. So that's what the utilities or the regulated utilities are required to do. But the other piece that's really important is the Public Utilities Commission. Our obligation is actually with oversight is to make, and section 65.2 of the public service law is explicit, that we're required to make sure that these responsibilities are carried out with due consideration of the economy, of efficiency, of preservation of our environment, and of preservation of natural resources. So my point in all this is that when you have all these factors looking at this, we're not talking about deregulating the distribution utility. What we're saying, we're not even saying we're getting rid of the regulatory compact. Utilities have an obligation to serve. They have an obligation to make sure that it's reasonable and efficient. What we also have an obligation to do is to make sure that the way they're serving that is evolving with the technology innovations that could occur so that we're doing it in the best way possible, consistent with these goods. So when the commission has looked at these things in the past, when we deregulated the industry in the 90s, it was all towards how technology is getting us in a better position on how we regulate. So with that, we identified in December, and this was in the context, actually, of our looking at our energy efficiency programs. Our energy efficiency program ends in 2015, round one. Now we're moving into round two in 2015 to 2020. It occurred to us that the programs that we have in place, and the issue was, you know, how are we going to restructure it? Was, well, we really can't restructure how we're going to deliver energy efficiency unless we really back up and think about how is the whole thing going to work together. And so it got, we realized that we really needed to take a step back and say, what is this business model the utility is going to evolve to in light of all the technological changes to make sure that we're doing the best possible way we can to meet our obligations to the citizens of New York. So we identify a number about, if I look at it, five or six different major policy concerns that we thought needed to be met. And a lot of these are also reflected in the state energy plan, or I would say we reflect a lot of what's in the state energy plan. I do have to remember my role every once in a while, but it essentially is consistent. So if we think about this, if one is customer knowledge and also the ability of the customers to manage their bills. So the critical issue is this. We've had deregulation in New York, since the 90s. But the real issue here is not whether customers should have the ability just to basically choose their supplier. It's how much control they have on how much they pay and what services they take, going back to this really meeting their objectives. But the reason why this is an important policy objective for us is that we're really starting to say, you know, we built the grid in the last century was really built from the really side that the customer is passive. Now we're talking about an active consumer. So if you were to really look at the system, let's look at it from the consumer's eyes of what the consumer would like to see. And so we should be thinking about restructuring the industry or what changes we need to make to the utility model based on meeting a consumer demand. The second policy is really animating markets. As I mentioned, a lot of these technologies are really reaching grid parity. They can stand on their own. The issue is how do we get the markets really working so we're bringing private capital in? So rather than continuing to have system benefit charges we charge to ratepayers, or different types of programs to incent people to invest in solar and things like that, as these costs are going down, how do we design programs so that, and how do we design the utility structure so that private capital can come in? And this becomes, in our view, then energy efficiency and clean energy is no longer then a peripheral aspect of utility business and utility operations, but central. And so when we're thinking about this, we're saying we want to meet these goals. One, we want to start with the consumer. Second, we want to animate real markets. So in other words, we've done a great job in the wholesale markets, but the retail markets are not as competitive. We still have vendors having to depend on state programs. How do we start looking at really developing real markets so this does become central? The third piece that we identified, and this is in the commission's order, is system efficiency. And it goes back to this issue of when you think about it, you know, the cost of supply and the cost of investment on the grid system is really driven by demand. And the more that you have demand that peaks, since it's instantaneous, the more you have to make investments to meet that system peak. If we can drive efficiency across the system so that you're actually managing demand, what you're doing is you're not only on an investment basis avoiding having to invest potentially in distribution, transmission, and generation plant just to meet a system peak, but on an operational basis, what you're able to do is start thinking about controlling load on an equal basis and an aggregate basis so that you're really then keeping the grid in balance by managing load effectively and managing generation effectively. So you're not only reducing investment, but operationally you're making the system itself much more efficient on a daily basis by using all those resources. So that is sort of an outcome we think you have to go. And I would say in New York, just as a plain fact, we have less than 100 hours a year where the market peaks. And that costs us a lot of money. If we could just get rid of that peak, where we would be doing an awful lot for consumers. And that's really about how to control demand. So that's one piece. The next piece that is fuel and resource diversity. I want to be really clear about this. We're talking about enabling a grid that allows for distributed resources that sit at the distribution level or behind the meter to be used as actively as resources that sit in front of the meter and central station. But we need diversity. So we need diversity of fuel. One of the issues we saw last winter If you become a system that's almost entirely gas dependent, it's not a good thing. We have an advantage in New York because we have a lot of hydro. We need to maintain that diverse mix of hydro, nuclear, solar, and things like that. That is extremely important. And we also need to recognize that it's going to be a combination of central generation and distributed generation. It's not an either-or equation. One of the things that our industry has done historically is sort of they rushed to an idea, and they said, it's all going to be this. And every time we decided to pick a technology and thought that that technology was nirvana, we were wrong. So let's all agree that we don't want to be that wrong, and it is a complement of resources. The other piece is system stability and resiliency, and I think that goes without saying. Now, one of the outcomes we have to recognize, and that means healthy utilities, it means a healthy market, is we need to be able to continue to invest, because as we continue to look at electricity as a primary energy source, and as we think about growing this economy and making sure that the cost of that product stays reasonable, we also need to make sure that people are going to be much more sensitive to outages. I think this community knows in New York City more than anything else the price when the system goes down. I think it was $50 billion that people are looking at after Sandy. We just can't afford not having a resilient system. So with that, the commission is going to be issuing a formal order this summer to talk about, to actually start looking at, well, what are the next steps? And a lot of this you heard this morning, but I want to be very careful. These are my ideas. The commission has yet to issue an order. But these are the elements that I believe that we're going to be needing to address to make this next level. So the first is really the operational model of the distribution utility. Historically, the distribution utility's really job was to maintain the wires, the system, to meet demand at all times. Now we're talking about moving to a grid where you have a lot of distributed energy resources. Are very dynamic. You add to that electric vehicles, batteries, all these pieces. You're going to have the distribution utility look a lot more like the transmission grid, where if we operate efficiently, what you want to do is have them to have access to all those resources so they can manage the system, both looking at resources that sit in front behind a meter or microgrids, as well as the grid itself, to drive basically in a way to become, people talked about it as the integrator. I would really think of it as a services model where you're really saying, how do I make sure that I'm using all the investment that wants to be used, that is available to be used, so that we're running the system as efficiently as possible? So they're really, in a way, in our situation, certain way, more like the independent system operator runs the transmission grid. In a sense, they're like the distribution version of that. So that's a real change in their model. The second piece that I think we need to look at is their job as a platform, because again, we're talking about enabling markets. What kind of information can the distribution utility allow for, provide, so that third parties can come in and provide their services to consumers that much better? What kind of data do they need to collect so that we can manage the system? And how do they provide that data? How do they charge for it? How is it provided so that, again, to animate these markets? So part of it is that they're not only as an integrator, but they're really at the platform company. We talk about it as the Internet of Things. Guess what? They're the Internet. And so what services should they provide, and how should they charge for them? But they do have to provide those services, because if not, third parties are going to continue to be dependent on pilots, on programs, and what we want to do is animate a market. The third piece of looking at that is, so that's the operation side. The second piece of the operation side is actually, and we talked about a little, is the interface with the ISO. Because it's part of this is then they're taking on a bigger role around operating load. So what's that relationship then between the distribution utility and the independent system operator? So the grid, again, is operated like a seamless integrated machine. This once you go off the operation model, then the next question is the investment model. Again, let me take you back, and if you haven't read it, it's a beautiful order. Look at the Con Ed order and the collaborative that we've done. But it's really thinking about resiliency. What do we need to build to in order to make the grid more secure? The second is what kind of systems do need to be put in place? We haven't really thought about that in the utility industry, but what kind of IT systems, control systems, data systems, things that the utility needs to invest in to enable this platform to exist. The other piece is what happens on resources behind the meter. So again, we have a number of utilities who are looking at microgrids. We have a program, actually, that the state announced about a competition for utility-based community-based systems. And it's really starting to think about, okay, well, if we're starting to look at not just investing in wires, but putting in distributed generation, putting in storage, putting in solar, and we're going to be and control systems at buildings, and going to be relying on those systems to manage the grid, what's the investment requirements of the utility? And then if the utility is really relying on these systems for reliability, how do they ensure that those systems are there? And so those are sort of, and so part of the issue that we're going to have to address, and I'm not saying here's the answer, but should utilities be allowed to invest in these resources? Should they use RFPs? How do we make sure if they do invest, it's equitable to systems that they own and not own? For those of you who have been around, sound like 1988 all over again. But we are going to have to think about those issues as part of our proceeding. The other thing the next thing is the transaction model. And people talked a little bit about this today. But I sort of, from my own mind, because I have to break things down, there's the business model, there's the investment model we have to rethink, and then there's the transaction model. The issue here is who pays for what. So for example, we're going to have services, and people talked a little bit about the telephone, and when we deregulated telephone, we came up with this terminology, POTS, plain old telephone service. What is basic utility service that the utility gets to charge to end-use customers, because that's who they charge today, for basic service that everyone gets, that they have to provide to everyone? And how do we define that? Because then the next question, what are the adjacent services? So today, for example, utilities in New York provide billing services to retailers. And they charge for those services, and those revenues come back to help defray revenue requirements. In the future, there are going to be a lot of things that utilities can provide. And let me give you an example concretely of what I'm thinking about. So let's say, for example, one of the utilities things that they want to do is they want to take an MRI. Those who know my history, I use medical terminology these years. So all the buildings that are within their footprint. And they know within those buildings how they're using electricity, where they're efficient, where they're inefficient. And not only that, they know, because they know their system, where it would be most useful for someone to invest in distributed generation, in solar, in storage to help the system. That's hugely valuable information. Now, the utility probably has to worry about, well, now I've created this huge database, and it's valuable to third parties who might want to come in and say, great, if I can get that information, I can go and talk to these customers and, really reduce my transaction costs. So why shouldn't they charge for it? Because if they charge for it, then those revenues, I'm not saying they deregulate, can go in to defray their revenue requirements that would otherwise be charged to end-use customers. And isn't that great? Because again, we have someone has to pay for this, and you have third parties who are going to be making money. And this is information, I look at it as Google. Every time Google sells somebody about what kind of things I buy, you bet they charge. Why wouldn't utilities charge? And it goes back to the end-use customer, but it comes as a revenue reduction. And then the question is, we call those in the telephone industry, call these adjacent services. But basically, they're above the line revenues, but they were charged. Now, the issue is, how do they charge? Well, one is you could use cost of service, but what if, in fact, Google comes in, and they're putting these Nest thermostats, and they're putting other devices, and they're saying, well, we can get that same data, you third party, and we'll charge you a buck. Well, we don't want our utilities charging $20. If there's a competitive alternative for a buck, we're going to want them to price it, because again, any revenue they get in is going to help defray the revenue requirements we put on end users. So we have to start thinking about then, how do we set this transaction up? What kind of flexibility do we need? And we do this in telephone in this state, as we call it, light-handed regulation. And it may be that it's not full cost of service. Maybe it's a fee. Maybe it's a fee that changes over time as more competition that comes in. But that's what we need to think about, is sort of this transaction. It's not all going to be end users, and there's going to be different ways to charge. The third piece of the transaction model is when the utility pays. And we talked about this a little bit, you know, where we are with net metering. Again, we think about the transition. But the fact of the matter is, where we want to move to is that the utility provides full value payment for these resources behind the grid. So for example, if the utility becomes the aggregator of aggregators and is billing in all the demand into the wholesale market, if they were a broker, they would charge a buck per transaction for everyone who kind of now is being able to use this information to make money out of the wholesale market. And what that does is that it begins to defray their costs, but the utility may then be paying at the same time for these distributed resources because they're providing support to the grid. And if they provide full value for those resources, then we get out of this net metering issue because we're fully valuing things sitting behind the meter and on the system. The other piece of that is thinking about how they pay is also, again, is sort of what tariffs they need to be put in place. And the other piece is that their ability to pay for these services, both for the reliability they provide as well as economic value. So, you know, looking at these different payment streams. So that's sort of, in my mind, we have to deal with all three. What do they do? How do we set the investment standard? And how do they pay and how do they charge? The last piece that I think is going to be probably, in my mind, some of the probably more complicated things moving on is where do we start and where end? Because we know where we want to end up. So one of the things, again, I come from PJM wholesale markets. We started the wholesale markets in 1997. We started with just real-time pricing. Then we added day ahead. Then we added transmission congestion pricing. It took us 10 years. And this was with players who were very sophisticated. A lot of them were traders in a lot of markets, but it takes a while. And I'm not saying we're going to take that long, but we need to recognize is that one of our big things here is we want to animate markets. We want to get started in the best possible place, and then we want to have the flexibility to transition as these markets develop, because they will develop, and they're going to develop in ways that we are not anticipating. So we need to be willing to be flexible, but we also need to recognize in these first few years we have to be highly successful. So if we're a bit more cautious, it's not because we're timid, it's because we want to make sure we don't make any mistakes that we find ourselves having to dig out from, and it takes harder to dig out than it would have been to build in an appropriate way. So I think one of the most important things we'll be talking about in this proceeding is what do we want to accomplish in the first few years to set ourselves on the path and give us the ability to transition to the future in an effective way. And as everyone knows, I'm an incredibly impatient person, so for me to say that is really hard. The other things that I think that we need to deal with is the next thing is customers. So that's the other thing that we've learned in New York. Again, we've had retail competition for a long time. The commission did a study we just released on how competition is working. What we found out is that it's working extremely well for the industrial market, not working well for the mass market. And so one of the things we need to look at is and people say the same with energy efficiency programs. We just can't underestimate that, you know, those of us in the room who are interested in this issue, we think about it all the time, but getting the mass market educated is going to take us all in the same boat pulling in the same direction. So we need to get the customers to understand what we're doing and why. And that's going to be government and utilities and NGOs and vendors and everyone. That education piece is a heavy lift that we'll need to continue to work on. The other is the investment community. As we think about, and I missed one piece, the regulatory model. We are going to have to look at moving to an outcome-based regulatory model, one with incentives based on the desired outcomes that look at plans. And people have mentioned New York already uses forward test years. We've already done unbundling. We actually also have rate plans, multi-year rate plans, but we need to make this an institutional norm, and we need to think about both the incentives and the penalties that are consistent with the outcomes. So that's the other obvious big piece we have to tackle. But once we get that regulatory model, we also get the investment community. And one of the things that I've learned in New York is that, you know, things can happen in other states, but when things happen in New York utilities, the investment community is right here looking at it. And so we need to make sure they understand where we're going and they have the certitude and the confidence in the model. And then the last thing we have to do is, not last, but the other thing is we have to look at wholesale retail, making sure these markets are fully aligned. And in that, we have a huge advantage. We have a market that works well. We are a single state ISO. So unlike in PJM in New England, it's not like we have to bring other states along with us. But it's very important that the wholesale market really starts looking at how the retail market can provide value. So I have 5 minutes. I will take questions. Maybe they'll give us a break and you can have more time. But thank you very much. And you know, obviously, guys, we have a lot to do. But we have a great staff, we have a great community, and I think we're going to have a lot of fun. So thank you. You can call him.
Okay.
I'll grab my wallet.
Great. So Chair Zibelman's graciously agreed to take some questions. So if people want to come to the microphones.
And I can hear all the answers.
No? Okay. Well, I have a question. Maybe while people collect their thoughts.
He has a question.
My question was going to be, you mentioned several times, you know, that this is not the first time the PSE's tried to kind of reshape or restructure the industry. What lessons would you take from the last effort in the late 80s and the 90s to restructure for the current effort?
Well, if I can, I think the restructuring, the last effort, was really looking at the restructuring around mostly the bulk power market. And while we allowed for retail competition on the commodity, we really didn't spend time. This was on looking at how do you animate downstream markets. First of all, the technology wasn't as mature, but that really wasn't what we were focused on. We were really focusing on the wholesale supply market and how does that work and the commodity. But one thing we have learned, again, and I think this is probably the biggest lesson, is that when we created wholesale markets, all the players were in the markets. They were generators, they were transmission folks, they were utilities, they were marketers. They were paying attention. This is how they made money. In order for us to be successful at this next round of deregulation where you're really animating retail mass market, you've got to get the consumers there. And they are not market players now. We want them to be market players, but they have to be educated. So one way I want to educate them is pay them so that people understand that there's real value here for them. But the other is recognizing that we need to get them there, and it's a lot of education, a lot of work. It's not that it can't be done, because we've done it in telephone. It's just not being, I guess, naive. That most people don't spend their time thinking about electricity except when it's off, and then they're only thinking about one thing, which is when does it come back on?
Question?
Yeah, I have a question. I'm with Michael Wyman. I'm with a startup called Clear Grid, and I have a question around vegetation management. I know that when at the transmission level, NERC and FERC regulate vegetation management, especially since the 2003 blackout. As you see a kind of distribution system operator concept evolving and imaging data becoming cheaper, would you anticipate the state regulators, not just New York, but others, and this isn't really a New York question because the New York utilities have done a fairly good job here, but would you see state regulators potentially regulating vegetation management more closely?
Well, we already do in New York. We have requirements for utilities around reliability, safety. So while we don't, you know, micromanage how they do it, we do. All the New York utilities are on programs, and we will look at how their vegetation management practices actually affect their reliability. So we do regulate that.
Other questions? Yes.
Hi, David Sheeran of Power Solar. Thank you so much for your excellent presentation. We're very fortunate to have you. Question on real-time pricing of electricity. I come from the solar industry right now, benefit from net metering. However, we see the promise of using a market force is very exciting. Maybe you could talk about the possibility of real-time pricing and maybe also shed light on what exactly, how that can be implemented.
Sure. Well, we do actually have programs in New York that we're looking at time of use pricing. particularly around things like electric vehicles, where it makes a lot of sense. I think there's two things to think about, and this is something we fought, actually Alan Freifeld and I fought very hard at FERC, is that there's, when customers are buying energy, electric power, they very well may just want to buy at a price. They may just want to say, if somebody can offer them and say, your bill for electricity is going to be $150 per month, and that's all it's going to be. They may say, that's great. I don't want to think about it. I just want to buy it. But if that same vendor can say, but I'm going to put in this smart thermostat, and I'm going to put in these smart devices, and I'm going to control your demand, in addition to giving you a fixed rate for your bill, I'm going to give you basically give you money back every month so for playing in the market. There, in fact, the customer may want to see what the market prices are, because then it's a revenue transaction. So I think, in my own mind, when we think about this moving forward, it's really getting information into the customer's hand about their value of how they use energy, whether that transaction is a time of use pricing that they pay more if they use certain hours, or whether it's because they make more because they don't use certain hours. I think that's really going to be what the market, I would say the market should sort out between the retailers and the customer based on really the relationship they might want to have. The utilities, for example, might have a program that say, you know, on a demand response day, if you sign up for these programs, I'm going to control your air conditioners and I'll give you a credit against your bill. And that may be what the customer wants to see. So I guess my thinking about it is pricing is something that we should really allow the market to do, and it really becomes then a transaction between the customer and the vendor. I'm not sure, and I know time of use real-time pricing has seen real value. I'm just not sure if that's the only route we want to go, and because I also know there are plenty of people who will tell you they don't really want to see the volatility in their bill.
Well, that brings me to my question. How do you get people to care who don't pay electricity bills? It's like part of their rent, it's included, it's the government housing, it's whatever. Also, what are you going to do for people who still don't have electricity? Parts of Northern California, right below Oregon, are still very raw. A lot of those people even still don't have electricity. And why is it so expensive anyway?
Let me start with the California-Oregon issue. Mm-hmm. I don't know why they don't have electricity, but it seems like a very odd thing that we have parts of the country that it's not been electrified. But I don't know, and I think something.
It's a desert.
Well. Okay. Well, I think we could look at.
I did a residency for the Morris Graves Foundation. And he was a good friend of Merce Cunningham and Mark Tobey. And he had a place called The Lake, which is way up, right below Oregon. A lot of people there don't have electricity. And also, it's a big deal. He brought it in because he had a lot of money when he came in. And also, they don't have water. I didn't have water when I was there. I had to bring in water.
Okay.
Let me answer this very quickly. The cost of power is really driven by a lot, you know, a lot of different factors. Certainly, the amount of people per square foot will do that. Plus, you know, is, you know, the location, the cost of repairs, a lot of different elements and fuel. So there's a lot of various pieces that will go to drive the cost of power. But let me ask you, I think the question we really do need to address is how do we get, particularly in places like here where people may just, they may get an allocation from their landlord, they may not have really any effect, how do we get them to care? I think that is really the key issue of the education piece, is really going to get people to really think about power and think about how they use it and think about the effect, and then take a look at some of the other regulations, such as triple net billing and other pieces, so that consumers could actually see the value of being able to control demand better. Certainly, one of the things that we would expect to continue to do as a government is really look at the low-income programs, look at public housing, and where, in fact, you can't create a market, that's really where government belongs, is really continuing to work with the people who really need to be served, but the markets won't serve them.
Okay, one final question.
Yeah, could you address, do you feel we're helped or hurt by having individual states each pursuing their own energy policy, and what could be done in order to get states to integrate their policies more? For instance, we pay a lot more for electricity than just across the river, but it's not so easy to just bring that power from a cheaper state into a more expensive state. What could be done to address those kind of issues?
Well, those are really issues that are more related to actually the federal government because it's interstate. But quite frankly, we have a number of different projects between us and New Jersey to bring power from PJM into New York. And there are other projects that people are looking at, Canada, et cetera. So, you know, part of, you know, certainly the state has been supportive of those types of projects. I think from the standpoint of multiple states, one of the things that we have is certainly NARUC, which is the Association of Regulatory Utility Commissions, is certainly looking at these issues. We the states among the commissioners share information. I certainly I've developed relationships with a lot of our neighboring states. And one of the things that actually would be a great outcome, I think, is particularly because we have a number of our utilities are regulated by different states, is to see if we can get an alignment, because it'll be a lot easier for the utilities to implement programs if they could do it system-wide. So, you know, and I guess from a geographic basis, a lot of the issues that New York is confronting, Connecticut's confronting, Maryland's confronting, Massachusetts is confronting, there's no reason why we shouldn't be not lockstep, but certainly looking at an approach that is very consistent, so that people can implement it easier. And one thing I will just say, big piece of what we've got to do is reduce the transaction costs. So a lot of things that we did learn from the retail market, why it didn't work on the mass market, it's expensive to serve. So part of this is our lesson learned is to be, how do we reduce these transaction costs for customers?
Well, thank you very much, Chair
Zibelman.
Thank you.